Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I've received apologies from Gordon MacDonald and Colin Smith this morning, and Bob Doris is attending as committee substitute for Gordon MacDonald. Murdo Fraser has also been delayed and is expected to join us during the course of the meeting. So our first item of business is the final evidence session of the committee's post-legislative scrutiny of the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014. I welcome Tom Arthur, Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, who is joined by Graham Cook, Head of Procurement Services, and Nikki Archer, Head of Procurement and Commercial Policy from the Scottish Government. I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the committee, and thank you very much for the invitation to appear before you this morning. It seems clear that there is agreement on the importance of public procurement in Scotland, the role public procurement plays in delivering sustainable economic growth, as well as the big steps already taken to improve the way the public sector buys goods, works and services. The Act was intended to be powerful, placing sustainability and well-being at the heart of procurement activity, as well as being proportionate. It places a small number of general duties on public bodies and some specific measures aimed at promoting good, transparent and consistent practice. It has led to a range of measures to make procurement opportunities more accessible to SMEs, third sector bodies and supported businesses. These include advertising opportunities through Public Contracts Scotland, dividing contracts into lots, subcontracting opportunities through the supply chain and supplier development activities. We deliberately build on the legislative framework, developing business-friendly, easy-to-access training, guidance and support for businesses of all sizes. The results are demonstrated through the Scottish Minister's annual report on procurement activity that we just published this week. For example, out of the £16 billion Scottish public sector procurement spend, 56% went to Scottish businesses, 55% to Scottish SMEs, providing £7.5 billion to the Scottish GDP, along with 130,000 full-time equivalent jobs. We actively undertake research and engagement and then seek industry, public sector, third sector and supported businesses' feedback to test and inform our approach. We do this through surveys, commissioning research, our public supply group with industry representation and hosting supplier roundtables. The findings from these underpin the public procurement strategy for Scotland, developed across the sectors and with industry, which was published in April last year, a first in providing a high-level vision for Scottish public procurement. It is reassuring to hear those who have given evidence to the committee talk in favourable terms about the changes introduced by the legislation. The Act is critical in underpinning an approach to public procurement which is helping to create opportunity, boost inclusive and sustainable economic well-being, tackle inequalities and create real social impact. The journey is, however, not complete. We will always look at what more we could do to maximise the impact of public procurement in Scotland. And with that in mind, I very much welcome the committee's post-legislative review of the 2014 Act.
Thank you, Minister. The committee did decide to undertake an inquiry into the legislation because procurement is an issue that's come up in a number of different inquiries we've carried out since we were started work on these areas. When our very first session, we heard from the Chamber of Commerce and they said they had got feedback from members and people would generally give the Act a C-plus for its performance. They said it is helpful. There has been good progress, but there is still more progress to be made. So I'd be interested in where the Minister, kind of 10 years after the introduction of the legislation, feels that there could be some remaining challenges or opportunities where we could improve the legislation and where you think the legislation has been most successful.
I think one of the themes that's emerged from the evidence that the committee has taken is that we have a very good piece of legislation that was formulated, I think, on a largely consensual basis 10 years ago when it was going through Parliament, and also recognising that this sits within a much larger programme of public procurement reform, both preceding the introduction of the legislation and since then. I think for one of the challenges that remains is around consistency of application and the variation it can exist between different contracting authorities and the perceptions that can create amongst suppliers. So with regards to how we have sought to address that, it's through providing a comprehensive suite of guidance, support, training, engagement. For example, if you go onto the PCS website, you will find links to the procurement journey, the supplier journey, the supplier development programme, which we contribute funding towards. We also keep a suite of guidance up to date and are always working to engage with stakeholders in terms of the development of our policy. So we recognise that there is remaining challenges, there always will be, around that consistency of application. But the legislation provides a solid foundation, and we remain committed to continue to engaging with partners to ensure that we can drive forward that consistency going forward.
In the early sessions, we also heard evidence about community wealth building and the pilots. I think there's five pilots across Scotland, and how they can be used. That model is positive in terms of supporting local supply chain. Do you have an update on where we are with the pilots, and how, what do you see the relationship between the community wealth building pilots and the legislation, if you agree that it's a way that we could try to promote and strengthen the effect of the legislation?
Yes, well, the five pilots have been in place for a number of years now. They operate in different contexts. I know there's been regards to Clackmannan, Shirton Fife, of course, the south of Scotland, Glasgow and the Western Isles as well. We've seen real progress there. There's been good engagement with CLEA, the Centre for Local Economic Strategies, who have worked in producing reports on the activities taking place there. I know the committee is familiar with some of the positive feedback it has been received in terms of increasing the impact of procurement locally from some of those pilot areas. What I would also want to note, of course, is it's not just the five pilot areas. We've seen other areas of Scotland taking forward community wealth building ambitions. And of course, no conversation of community wealth building could be complete without making reference to North Ayrshire, who of course were the pioneers in taking forward community wealth building in Scotland. And we've seen their approach grow to a regional approach, bringing in East Ayrshire, South Ayrshire, the Health Board, the TSI, the College. So what we have seen with regards to community wealth building is further progress around the ambitions set out within the Act around that sustainable and progressive procurement. Community wealth building legislation is something that is a PFG commitment. We have consulted on that legislation and we published an analysis of it last year. We are currently considering in detail what the next steps will be with regards to what we received in terms of feedback via the consultation. It's of course, as the committee will be aware, spend procurement is just one of the pillars of community wealth building, an incredibly important one. Where community wealth building can really add that additional value is through bringing that strategic coherence across the five pillars, and that's one of the reasons why we have committed to legislation in PFG. There's a huge amount I can say about community wealth building, but I appreciate that might be straying beyond what we're specifically considering this morning.
That's helpful, thank you. As you've mentioned, Ayrshire, I'm going to bring in Brian Whittle with his question.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to your team. You'll be unsurprised to hear that I'm going to go on food procurement. Given the importance of public food procurement to things like health and education, we have heard that the proportion of locally produced food products available through the national framework has increased. I would say that's against a pretty low bar from last term. When I looked at this last term, it was sitting at about 16%. We have outliers like East Ayrshire, who are exemplary. They sit at about 75%. So they've shown us the way. And I think, as I said, the impact of food procurement, I think, is a special case because of its impact on health, education, but also things like circular economy and rural economy, and reducing emissions from not bringing in imports. So, with that in mind, do you think we're moving fast enough? Can we not move quicker? East Ayrshire have shown us the way; others are starting to follow. Should we not be pushing that harder?
Well, I think you raise a number of important points, Mr. Whittle, and I'm glad you took the opportunity to highlight East Ayrshire, who have been, I think, an inspiring example. I had the privilege a couple of years ago of visiting Mosskill Farm, who has benefited directly from the opportunities of working in partnership with East Ayrshire. And of course, East Ayrshire sit within that broader regional approach to community wealth building that I referred to earlier. I think what we have provided for already within legislation and in practice is supporting the objectives that you have set out, whether that be the opportunities for lotting. We've seen, for example, flexibilities around supply for those organisations that cannot necessarily are not necessarily in possession of the logistic capacity to deliver. So I know that is something that the committee will have heard about previously. Of course, there's the requirements around those contracting authorities that are obliged to publish a strategy and to report on it, to have a specific statement regarding their regulated procurement around food. So there's a strong foundation there. I think what we will have an opportunity to see going forward, as particularly as we look towards community wealth building legislation and the further foregrounding of these principles, will be to reiterate and to reinforce the importance of having that concern and looking for opportunities operating within the structures and the framework of procurement law to identify opportunities whereby local suppliers can be produced. So I recognise the desire to go faster. I think we've made solid progress. I think we've got a very strong legislative foundation. I think the example of East Ayrshire demonstrates what is possible. And of course, there will be that opportunity going forward to give this further consideration as we move forward with our community wealth building ambitions.
Do you think there's opportunity through the Excel contracts potentially to deliver sort of a more universal approach to this across Scotland, giving better choice through Excel contracts to push this faster?
Well, I know that from the evidence you've taken from Scotland Excel, how committed they are to engaging with suppliers and taking that very proactive approach, and the huge amount of work they do within that space. I think there's always, fundamental to procurement is a need to consider matters on a case-by-case basis, the need for it to be relevant to the particular circumstances and to be proportionate. I think the legislative framework that we provide affords that. What I think I'm keen that we continue to do, and I think that more coordinated approach through the community wealth building actions and work that we're undertaking is to help support more suppliers both to grow and develop and to be in a position where they can compete for and to win contracts and indeed to increase the number of suppliers that are available. Graeme, I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add just about implementation around these matters.
Thank you, Minister. So I'd like to add a bit about sharing best practice. So lots of best practice in the Scotland Excel frameworks, but the Scottish Government shares best practice through a number of different mechanisms. So case studies, the supplier, the procurement journey is updated constantly. These things aren't static. We have annual heads of procurement meetings where really good examples, such as has been discussed this morning, are shared with the entire public sector procurement community. There are more local clusters, there are sectoral meetings and so on. So right throughout the year, there's a number of different mechanisms where best practice examples and case studies are shared. So those exemplars really are shared right across the procurement community in Scotland.
I think food procurement specifically, I think, is one of those ones where there's a false economy and if we allow... I don't want to give accountants a bad name here, but if we let those who are in charge of the purse strings have too much of an influence on food procurement, do you think there's a drag there specifically around how we ensure that councils can afford the local good nutritional local food to be into the procurement process?
I think. And I respect the autonomy of local authorities in taking decisions which they feel are best for their areas. And of course, they have to operate within under the requirements of domestic procurement law. I think just picking up on the point that Graham made and the point that you referred to, Mr. Whittle, with East Ayrshire, and we discussed, I think there's a power always within an example. We can talk theory, but the example of other local authorities and can provide, and indeed the example of the best practice that we help to facilitate the sharing of, I think that can serve to demonstrate to other authorities, perhaps where there's inconsistency of practice, what the opportunities are. However, I do have to respect, in terms of taking these decisions, it will be for individual local authorities operating consistent with the requirements of the legislation, but ultimately taken by elected members who are democratically accountable to their electorates.
If I could just finish with one final question. We'd heard from the Scottish Wholesalers Association, and they're suggesting that rigid nutritional standards present a significant barrier to increasing this, the public procurement. And that you'll know that I am a stickler for having high nutritional value, but within that are things like, you know, shapes of pizza and that kind of thing. Do you think we're maybe creating too rigid a structure that potentially prevents, you know, this moving quicker?
Well, I would be speaking beyond my portfolio responsibilities if I strayed into the territory regarding food regulation and the specifics. There will be very sound set of reasons for why those particular standards and guidance are in place. But what I think is important from a procurement perspective is that we continue to have a system and we continue to further develop a system that's not only open and transparent but allows opportunities for that continued engagement with suppliers. And if we look at the other broader levers we have to support suppliers and being able to meet the requirements and the demand of public sector procurers.
I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Just in relation to that question, I mean, the evidence we heard from Colin Smith from Scottish Wholesale Association around the rigidity was quite convincing, whether it was about cheaper pizzas, but also about difficult buying, particularly kind of bakery products from Scottish suppliers because it didn't meet what the nutritional standards were. So I don't know if maybe just from the Minister, if we can maybe get a commitment that you would have a conversation with the department that is responsible, with the Minister who's responsible. We do all support good nutritional standards in schools, but if there was a conversation to take place about what impact this might be having on procurement and might be presenting barriers to getting local or Scottish suppliers for certain products, that would be welcomed by the committee.
No, I'm more than happy to do that. I recognise this is one of a number of areas where there will always be tensions, because there will always be tensions that exist within procurement. With your permission, Convener, can I bring in Nikki Archer just to say a few words?
Just to add that the current setup and policy does allow us local organisations to specify requirements based on plans that are of food that is fresh, nutritional, in season. They're able to design protected geographical indicators within their requirements. They're able to specify recognised assurance schemes like Quality Meat Scotland, supply and design menus around free-range, organic, vegan, etc. So there's a lot of flexibility in the rules just now to implement really good practice within the rules in terms of what we're looking at today.
Mm. And that wasn't the evidence that we heard particularly from Scottish Wholesale Association. So if there was to be a conversation held, I do understand what Nikki Archer has outlined to us, but that would be appreciated by the committee. Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Colin Beattie to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Mayor. Minister, we're all aware of the tremendous challenges that face every organisation at the moment due to the financial situation, the tight budgets. Is there a danger that these pressures on the public finances are going to dilute the importance of the quality aspects of procurement activity?
I think it's an important point that you raise, and it's in any time of challenging financial circumstances, that particular tension will always be present across a range of policy areas. It's important to reiterate, as the committee is aware and has heard from other witnesses, of the way in which procurement operates within Scotland and the decisions we took through the 2015 regulations that contracts will not be awarded solely on basis of lowest cost. On the issue of that ratio between price and quality, again, that comes down to the decisions that are taken on a case-by-case basis. But I do recognise the challenging financial circumstances that we're in and the concern that that raises. But the way in which procurement operates within Scotland and the obligations around regulated procurement are such is that there needs to be that balanced approach to decision-making.
In the evidence we've taken, it was made clear that decisions on procurement were taken not always on the cheapest price, but on the cheapest over a period, such as in theory anyway, spend money now, save money in the future. But the pressures, the financial pressures that are on now, are going to put that in the back burner, realistically. Everyone's looking short term, everybody's looking to try to close that budget gap now. How do we monitor that? How do we understand that issue? How do we manage that?
Well, I think with regards to the point around monitoring, that is where the requirements around publication of strategies and reporting are very important for those public bodies operating above the threshold. So that gives a direct answer to how we can monitor this. That process of continued engagement that I've previously spoken about, as well as the work we do in terms of constantly updating our guidance, that is something which gives us a means of responding to any matters that should develop. So we will, of course, continue to monitor as reports are published and through our ongoing engagement with, for example, heads of procurement, what the particular dynamics within the system are. It is a challenge, of course, given the financial context that we are operating within currently. We have been through a huge degree of pressure. So, of course, we will continue to monitor that, but I would refer back to the requirements under the existing legislation and specifically as well on that point around our ability to be able to understand what's happening, the reporting requirements too.
Still looking at resources, we've heard, and I'm looking here at contracting authorities, we've heard of pressures due to lack of resources, both in terms of time and skills. In order to maximise effective procurement and commissioning practice, how do the Scottish Government and other bodies effectively pool and share procurement resources, and how could this be improved to better support contracting authorities?
Well, there's a huge amount of collaboration and activity goes on. Maybe just picking up on the first point around in terms of that human resource, ensuring we've got the people in place to do that. We've got a really strong and quite a powerful story to tell about the work that the Scottish Government has been undertaking in that. And I'll maybe just ask Nicky Archer to come in and provide some more information.
I think one of the important factors is to realise that procurement is part of a much wider system. And what we're finding, in addition to all of the best practice and the collaboration that the Minister and Graeme Cook have referred to, also the earlier that we are involved, if local leaders ensure and service delivery managers ensure that procurement is engaged much earlier in the planning and scoping stages of projects and programmes, then that allows us to explore the art of what's possible and feasible through procurement to deliver on these wider ambitions. And that allows us to get to market earlier, to give more advanced notification to markets. And that, of course, strengthens our ability to deliver a really good balance of cost and quality. So there's a number of themes in terms of what we're trying to do for that earlier engagement and targeted development and best practice sharing. Thank you.
I hear what you say in terms of the ideal approach. The evidence we've been getting is that certainly the key contracting authorities in Scotland are struggling. They're struggling with resources. They're struggling with the skills even to do this. When we talked to one panel, we were talking about this question of, you know, do you take the cheapest deal or do you take the deal that's going to give you the savings over a period consistently, sustainably? And the problem that some of them had was they didn't have the resources to do these rather more complex calculations and so on, which are important, you know, for long-term investment. How can you support them in this?
There's a lot of support that we do provide, and I recognise that the fundamental point that I think you're driving at is that we want a system where we don't pay a good price for a fair product, but a fair price for a good product. That has to be at the heart of what we're doing around procurement. But in terms of some of the work that we're doing around that engagement and providing support, I'll ask Graeme to come in.
Thank you. So in terms of expanding the collaboration, the Scottish Government full national suite of frameworks, contracts and support, we're looking to expand that now and so move into to further category areas, and that will help to ease some of the pressure, release some of the resources locally if more things are done centrally. I think, as you've heard in some of the evidence sessions, centralisation doesn't necessarily mean a loss of local need, local considerations. So in terms of the categories that will be bought on a collaborative basis, we're looking to increase those. And through the various means of sharing best practice as well, that also saves significant resource locally, because if you know if someone's bought something recently, you can borrow their get hold of their documents. And in terms of the procurement reform programme, that's been, I think, one of the biggest impacts of the reform programme that started back in 2006. It is building that community of procurement professionals on which we can rely to give these examples to save huge amounts of time where we're not having to reinvent the wheel. So it is already very successful. As with all of these things, I think there's space to do more.
Mark Dufraser to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Apologies for being a few moments late at the start of the meeting due to traffic. We've taken quite a lot of evidence, Minister, from the business community about some of the challenges they face in terms of accessing public sector contracts. So I've got a few questions I want to ask around that particular space. So first of all, one issue we've heard is about resource constraints being a key factor, particularly for smallest businesses trying to engage with public procurement. And the committee has heard that funding for support services like the supplier development programme has fallen in real terms. So what more can be done to try and assist businesses, particularly the smallest businesses, who want to access public contracts but are struggling to do so with a lack of resource?
Well, I appreciate the question. I would want to put on my record and thanks to SDB for the outstanding work that they do. I think we would all recognise that. Well, there's a number of activities that take place. I think we have continued to provide funding for SDPs. It's one of a number of partners who fund SDP, and of course they have a range of activities in terms of training, guidance, local and regional meet the buyer events. Government works in terms of some of the national events that create opportunities for suppliers to engage directly with buyers as well. There's the range of guidance that we've touched upon earlier in relation to other questions that we provide via if you go to Public Contracts Scotland, you will find all the links to the various support that we provide in that regard. So there's the online activity that is the work that we do to support SDP. Maybe just in terms of more broadly around practice, around engagement, I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add, Graham.
Pre-commercial engagement, as we call it, is a really important part of successful any successful procurement, be it public or private. And so that engagement, and Nikki mentioned earlier, the early engagement of procurement is essential, because not only will the advice be coming in at a more effective time, it also gives an opportunity to discuss the requirement with the market. And we find that that's particularly important for SMEs. So we're looking to see what we can do to increase the use of that pre-commercial engagement stage and roll it out through all of the best practice forums that I've mentioned.
OK, thanks for that. You referenced the Public Contracts Scotland website. And we've heard some feedback about that, that while that's a welcome portal, it's starting to feel dated. It could be brought up to date. I know there is a plan to potentially retender that and reinvent it. So what are the improvements you'd like to see through a new portal that would make it more user-friendly?
Well, one of the things we're doing, this works at a very early stage, so it's scoping out. As the committee will have heard from previous witnesses, we have started that process of engagement. Very much at the moment, it's about building up that evidence base. So rather than government presupposing what PCS should look like, it's working to understand more fully that feedback and those particular issues that have been raised that you're referring to, Mr. Fraser. So we're going to have that process of engagement, and that will help to inform the work we do in this space. And of course, as we go forward in that, I'd be more than happy to keep the committee up to date. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, Nikki.
I was just going to add that actually about almost 90% of current supplier registrations on the portal are actually SMEs. And one of the things that we do quite regularly is survey our users of the portal to understand how we can improve it. And through time, we've taken action to improve it. But again, it gives us a really good access to feedback about what the system of the future should look like. And, you know, one of the challenges of being an early adopter of best practice is, you know, soon in time, everybody else catches up and you're the one that's out of date. So this early scoping work is really important to our future moving forwards. But we've done quite a lot of work over the last year following a business and parliament session that the minister and myself attended to work with FSB, Women in Enterprise and other members of the procurement suppliers group to pull together kind of one-stop shop guidance on sources of support for SMEs and third sector on how to engage with and to win business. And that seems to have been quite well received. And we've got further work underway to develop and publish an SME and third sector action plan, which we hope to have out by the end or as near to the end of this month as we can.
I would touch as well as we look forward to community wealth building legislation who have been engaged with closely in the FSB on that. Increasing opportunities for local suppliers and SMEs is going to be crucial to the success of that approach as well.
So you said that the work's at an early stage. Do you have a likely timescale to be progressing this?
I can't confirm a timescale at the moment because we're still at that early stage. Okay. But as I said, I'd be more than happy to update the committee in due course on that work and respond to any further questions at that point if the committee may have. I appreciate it's a strong point of interest and it has been raised by witnesses to the committee.
Okay. Can I ask a slightly different point, which is around the question of feedback to unsuccessful bidders? Again, we had this from small business and they were saying that it can be discouraging where a lot of work goes into putting in a bid, the bid's unsuccessful, and they don't get any feedback or very little feedback in terms of how that bid might be improved in terms of future bids. So you get any thoughts on how that process might be improved?
Well, I think it comes back to that question of what's in the legislation and around implementation. The committee's familiar with the requirements under the legislation around regulated procurement and provision of feedback and opportunities for further engagement. I know that the committee, in terms of taking evidence, will be aware that there are many buyers who are more than keen to engage with suppliers who are unsuccessful, because that feedback is so important in allowing suppliers in the future not only just to stay engaged with the public procurement system, but to enhance their capacity and ability and their opportunities for winning contracts in the future. In terms of that point around implementation, about how we seek to ensure the Act and the requirements of the Act are effectively carried forward, I'll ask Graeme to come in.
Thank you. So all bidders are entitled to request feedback. Good feedback does take a lot of work to provide. Everyone is always happy to provide that. It's not automatically provided. There are suppliers who aren't all that interested in receiving the detailed feedback. Few and far between, I would suggest, but they do exist. So I wonder if there is something in the distinction between the entitlement to ask, and perhaps some suppliers don't know they're entitled to ask for further feedback after they've been told the result of a competition. So I think that's where things like the supplier journey, the supplier development programme and so on are critically important, so that all bidders really do understand their full rights to feedback within the procurement system.
Okay, thank you. Just one more question on a slightly different point. The procurement legislation has different thresholds, £50,000, £2 million, associated thresholds for the quick quote system, £4 million threshold for community benefit requirements. These thresholds haven't changed since the Act was introduced in 2014. Obviously, we've had inflation since that time. Is the government giving any thought to whether those thresholds are still appropriate or whether they need to be reviewed?
as part of the community wealth building legislation is a process and the consultation, as well as a specific question around the proposed duties, we asked for any feedback across the five pillars of community wealth building. There was specific feedback suggesting changes to thresholds within procurement legislation. I'm not in a position at the moment to say what the government response to that is, as we're still giving a very detailed consideration, but it is something that was raised as part of that process and it is something we're giving detailed reflection on.
Well, one more question, if I can, on the quick quote system, which we heard some very positive things about from people who used it. Do you know how many local authorities actually use quick quotes? Because I was told, and I've not had a chance to verify this, that only 3 out of 32 actually made use of the quick quote system. But do you have any knowledge of that?
So there's two sides to quick quote, I would say. There's a system within PCS, which is, if you like, the inbox. So you can use that to receive quick quotes. There's then the concept of that level, that small level of competition. So every single public body in Scotland uses that small level of competition. I can't say whether or not every single public body is still using the PCS electronic inbox, because as mentioned, the system is getting a bit long in the tooth. So it may well be that some local authorities choose not to use that inbox and use a different one, but they're nonetheless still using the quick quote concept of a smaller, quicker, more efficient level of competition for lower value, lower risk procurements.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Bob Doris, did you wish a supplementary?
Just very briefly, if that's okay, Convener. I think I was previously substituted on this committee when a similar line of questioning was been asked to other witnesses. So can we just get confirmation that all bidders are definitely entitled to feedback and it's not just bids over a certain value? That's the first thing. But I'll roll the questions together for brevity, if that's helpful. So that's the first thing. And the second thing is, I do remember asking at a previous committee whether any monitoring is done of unsuccessful bidders and whether a lack of feedback or the lack of success deters them from future applications and whether any monitoring was done of that. And my understanding is no monitoring was done of that. Is that something that government's aware of or something the government's going to consider analysing to see if more needs to be done? Because obviously an unsuccessful bidder is still building up the expertise to bid successfully in the future.
I'll come ask Nicky to come in a moment. I think it's an important point you raise. I just would highlight, as I think has been suggested previously, the important about in terms of what's required is it being proportional. We've already had an exchange regarding the pressures and the resource challenges that we already face at the moment. But on the specific points, I'll ask Nicky to come in.
Certainly, they're entitled to ask for feedback, and it's not only to unsuccessful bidders, it's also to successful bidders on what made them successful. And our, there are many suppliers who are bidding to track and to follow trends is nigh on impossible. But the theory is that we're providing them useful feedback that will help them to improve their bid the next time, which helps us. So we help them to help us in the future bids. So we should certainly be providing good feedback to bidders when requested.
Okay. Can I just check if that's the completeness of the answer? Because I get that resources are an issue, convener, and providing detailed feedback for everyone. But a sample exercise could quite easily be done of 50 unsuccessful bidders over a period of time to find out if they reapply or 100. Apologies, I don't know what an appropriate number would be, but some kind of data analysis could be done. Has that been considered? Because I think that's what I was asking, Fiona. Has that been considered? Or if not, would it be considered?
So we do actually run supplier surveys and we do look at the range of questions that we ask. So it's certainly something that could be considered. We're due to be looking at further surveys this year. The last one was published in, 2021. We're trying to look at matters that are of importance and events like this help to inform what we decide to put in there. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman to be followed by Kim Stewart.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for your contribution so far. In the 10 years since the Act was passed, we've seen more focus on climate impact of our work and on the shift to net zero, renewed interest in community wealth building that you've spoken about already, and the development of regional economic partnerships to focus on local resilience and local sustainability and the like. And the five-year procurement strategy published last year, for the vision in that focuses on maximising value for the people of Scotland, putting public procurement at the heart of a sustainable economy. I wonder what your thoughts are around how we are actually seeing how are we using procurement to the best possible effect to meet the challenges in the 2014 Act around the sustainable procurement duty to deliver the positive social and environmental outcomes that we hope procurement can, or we know procurement can?
I think this touches again upon this distinction between what we have in legislation and implementation and the questions around consistency or variation. I think what we have in legislation is very strong, and as I touched on before, I think it's supported by a comprehensive package of guidance, toolkits and engagement. So there is a lot of positive work being undertaken in procurement per se. I think, touching on the community wealth building point, which I know you have a strong interest in, that more coherent and joined up approach across different pillars of economic development, I think will afford us opportunities to go further than we have currently. But with regards to what we have at the moment, and as reflected in the independent report that was published recently on the journey we've been on in sustainable procurement over the last two decades, I think we have a very strong story to tell, and we have made significant progress. In terms of some of the policy aspects and maybe some of the successes that have come from that, I don't know if you'd maybe want to add something, Nikki.
I was just going to add that there is a challenge on balancing the various outcomes we're looking for. There's always a tension between competing pressures. But one of the things that we use quite heavily across the public sector, and it's been recognised internationally, is our sustainable procurement tools system, which helps buyers to go in with their customers and ascertain what the biggest bang for the buck is, let's say, in terms of the balance of social, environmental, economic outcomes, as well as sustainability and innovation. So those tools are very important. But we've got an awful lot of examples of good practice, and that's one of the reasons it's so important that people that spend above a certain amount must publish their strategies, setting out how they will use procurement to deliver against the sustainable procurement duty, but not only do that, but annually report with evidence how they're doing that in practice. And then we gather and analyse all of those reports, so, around about 115, don't quote me, to set out in the Minister's annual report what is that evidence of good practice with some examples. So it's quite a big focus for us to make sure, because we use those examples of good practice to share, we develop case studies, and we put those in the tools to help others to learn and to adapt and apply.
I could give a few examples that have been drawn through those annual reports, if that would be helpful. Yeah. So Perth and Kinross Council, their Tay Link Road procurement, the tenders were required to state what carbon reduction initiatives would be implemented if these bidders won. The Scottish Government's print design and associated services procurement, very specifically reduced waste and minimised the use of non-environmentally friendly raw materials. And the Scottish Government's General Office Supplies Framework, which is used right across the public sector in Scotland, reduced the frequency of deliveries through consolidation and minimum order values. So something as simple as a minimum order value can reduce the number of journeys, the number of deliveries, and also combine two separate frameworks, which cut in half the delivery miles, and it also uses electric or low emission vehicles. So these are the sorts of examples that get pulled through the requirements of the annual reports, and then the summing up of those annual reports, which are required as part of the 2014 Act.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful and interesting to hear those examples. We've heard from witnesses previously that you know, there's a lot of goodwill and a lot of good intention, but quite often price will drown out the other factors, and we actually heard it negates the other factors, the positive social or environmental outcomes. We've also heard that the reducing inequalities element has kind of got lost as far as measuring the social and environmental outcomes is concerned. And a specific example, I suppose, and this maybe links to the threshold point, with subcontracting and secondary and you know, supply chains down the way, because they aren't the contractors, they're not obliged to provide the kinds of information around the environmental and social outcomes. How can we actually ensure that we see that maximising value thing in the round rather than just that focus on price?
I think maybe just ask Graeme first, just to come in terms of that particular point around implementation regarding subcontracting, and I'll come back.
So subcontracting and really scrutinising a supply chain in detail, as with all things procurement, it has to be proportionate. There's an awful lot of supply chains for very small amounts of money. And if we were to require a provider, a supplier, to do an awful lot of additional work for a relatively small contract, it represents quite a barrier. That's what they quote as the unnecessary bureaucracy. So we really need to work hard to balance all of this. In larger contracts, in contracts that have a higher environmental risk or a higher opportunity to, for example, deliver social outcomes, then we will look, public bodies will scrutinise, and those supply chains will have those regular contract supplier meetings. But yeah, it has to be done on that proportionate basis. And this does pull through the annual reports where there's successful implementation of policy in the supply chain. We're seeing it in the annual reports.
This, again, it gets to that tension spoken about earlier, those tensions that exist within procurement and what we want procurement to do. We have come a long way in recent decades in how procurement operates. And I think in the last 10 years we have seen real progress. It's partly in terms of what's been delivered by this Act, part is the broader work around procurement reform that the Scottish Government has been undertaken. And I understand the appetite, and I share it, to always see what more can procurement do, and touched upon that with community wealth building. But it does always come back to that point around proportionality. We are talking in a fundamental sense about the delivery of goods, services and works, which are essential for the functioning and operation of the public sector. But we want to do so in a way whereby we can help in such a way that we can maximise the wider impacts that has. And one of the things that's reflected in the report, looking at, you know, 20 years in this sustainable procurement journey, is the fact that these considerations have went from being an add-on to being a golden thread that goes right through the process. And I think that speaks more broadly to aspirations about what we talk about with community wealth building, with sustainable economic growth, with sustainable development, with a well-being economy, however one wishes to go and particularly phrase it. That broader consideration of the social and environmental as well as the specific economic outcomes been a much more upstream concern, and I think we are seeing that change happen within procurement. But this speaks to the broader point of implementation, and it's something that you've heard from a number of witnesses in front of the committee, is that we have policy, we have legislation, but culture and practice is important as well. And that is something that will take time, but I think we can see 10 years on from this Act being passed that we have made significant progress, and I think that's reflected in the annual reports we see, as well as that independent review of the progress that we've made over the last couple of decades.
Okay, thanks for that. You talked there, Tom, about the delivery of goods, services and works, but around that also come the jobs and pay and conditions of the people delivering those goods, services and works. And it's not just those individuals, it's the communities that they then live in and support and those local economies. And we can see the tracking of fair work requirements through some of the contracting processes, and I take what you say about the bureaucracy of following that all the way through. We've seen, I think, really positive progress, as you've outlined, around the real living wage, but that's something that's easily defined, it's easy to measure, it's easy to monitor. There's maybe been less progress on specific things around gender representation and carbon accounting, for instance. And I wondered what thought the Scottish Government has given to helping define what we mean by progress in those things a little bit more clearly, because they're fundamental to what we mean by sustainable communities upon which, you know, that rely on the economies we're talking about. But if we don't have a clear understanding of what we mean when we're talking about gender equality, when we're talking about carbon accounting, then the suppliers, those who are delivering the goods, services and works, are kind of working, not blind. They're working with good intention, but not very, very clear, not a very, very clear, clearly defined focus of outcome.
I think the committee will recognise that the legal environment that we have to operate within procurement around equal treatment and non-discrimination within regards to regulated procurement and our obligations under GPA, etc. But I think on the point around gender you make, part of that can be looking at the supply side and the work we do, work in terms of engaging with suppliers and all of the bits of work I've spoke about previously. I don't know, Nicky, if you want to pick up, because you made reference to the Business and Parliament event, and this was something that we had, an extended conversation on.
A couple of thoughts were going through my head there, Minister. One was just on the concept of carbon counting, where I think there's a risk in unreliability and conflating spend with emissions, and there's a whole industry out there on different ways to do that. So the way that we're working on it is to make sure that we're focused not just on how we buy, but whether we buy at all. The make-buy decision stops that carbon counting right at source. You know, what we're buying and building it into the specification, how much we're buying, which gives you those twin issues of, you know, lower budgets, but also stopping the carbon cycle and the scope 3 emissions. In terms of looking at the social aspects, we've got community benefits through procurement, a long-standing and very positive history of embedding community benefits through procurement, not just above the threshold for community benefits, but actually people volunteering to use them for below thresholds and looking at getting protected characteristics back into work, into apprenticeships. So there's quite a lot of focus there and quite a lot of commitment to do things in that space. And when you're looking at another example, if you look at, for example, the Independent Advocacy Service, you know, there was so much engagement up front with people from a disabled background to understand how they could access the services, so that we built and incorporated that into the way that we delivered those services. So there's lots of ways to balance these kind of, you know, if we're getting local suppliers and local interpreters, then that also affects the carbon footprint. So there's, you know, a lot of mutuality in all of this.
Complex and interconnected.
Very much so, and on a case-by-case basis. And that is why you need professional buyers to assess the marketplace to understand what the right balance is to play in each situation based on the market dynamics.
OK, thanks.
Thank you. Just before I bring in Kevin Stewart, in relation to Maggie Chapman's questioning, the Minister will know the committee is about to undertake work into the disability employment gap. And one of the areas we discussed was supported workplaces and where they fit into the procurement services. We did hear people being positive about reform of the reserve contract regulations, which we're opening up to supported businesses. But I don't know if the Minister wants to say a bit more about how we or how public procurement can support supported businesses. And I mean, they are, we had reports that there are some barriers in terms of it's quite narrow, the areas in which they can participate in, or it can be difficult to match up. I mean, do you think there needs to be more work to recognise the role that supported businesses can play, and how do we make it easier for them to access public procurement?
I agree entirely. I had a visit to a supported business yesterday. I've got a visit to another one next week. Scotland XL ran an excellent event for supported businesses last autumn, which I was privileged to attend and speak at. Committee will be aware of what is set out within the legislation, but in terms of some of the work we're undertaking at the moment around dynamic purchasing, I'll maybe ask Graham to come in to say a few words.
Yeah. So the Scottish Government has it's a bit like a framework, a dynamic purchasing system that allows new businesses as they emerge, as they move into markets, to join. That's the kind of the main difference between a dynamic purchasing system, a DPS, and a normal framework. So there's a DPS specifically for supported businesses. Now that's accessible right across the Scottish public sector. And in 2021-22, across the 110 public bodies that published an annual report for that year, £27.9 million in regulated contracts went to supported businesses. Now, some of that was through the framework, through the DPS, not all of it. The DPS is one route that can simplify access, but it's not the only route. But that's a significant sum that does already go to supported businesses. I think there's, as is always the case, great success, I think, but always room for more, which is why we moved from using the standard framework to the DPS system, so that as more businesses do emerge, or as more businesses, supported businesses, move into new markets and develop new products and services, they're able to join that system, and that they're not, if you like, cut out until the next time it gets renewed.
Okay, thank you. Kevin Stewart, followed by Bob Dawdus.
Thank you very much, convener. I do intend to ask some questions around about commissioning, but the exchange just now has been quite interesting, because, you know, this is the first that the committee has heard of dynamic purchasing systems, for example, which is, you say, different from a normal framework. Now, if that's the first that we've heard of this, you know, how do the folk out there that are trying to sell keep up with all of these tweaks, all of these differences as they appear?
I would just, we do all that we can to publicise and make that information as available, and I won't repeat the various partners that we work with and the suites of guidance we produce. So we'll continue to learn from this. And one of the things that I'll be very keen to learn from the committee's deliberations and its report is about what more we can do to increase awareness of the support that is available, and also to create an environment where we can encourage more SMEs and supported businesses to look for opportunities to engage with public sector procurement. But with regards to the specific point you raised, Mr. Stewart, about how we raise awareness, I would refer back to the points that I and officials have made previously around the suite of support and guidance and engagement that takes place already.
Let's move on to commissioning, because we have heard from many that good commissioning work can lead to some very good outcomes for people, and that's what we all want to see. However, we've also been told that competitive public tenders are not necessarily the most appropriate vehicles for that commissioning work. We have also heard that, you know, there's a perception that often when it comes to commissioning and the tender itself, that the accountants, the lawyers, have more influence over the tender when it comes to that work than those in the front line that actually know what is required. Do you have any comment on that, Minister, please?
I think it was a fundamental point about knowing what the need is that the procurement is seeking to address, and having that clear understanding. So with regards to commissioning, understanding what the need is, through that pre-market engagement with suppliers, ensuring suppliers have an understanding of what the need and demand to be met is. With regards to points around those officers who are involved in the administrative process and around drafting and decision making, that will be for, of course, the individual contracting bodies, but they do have a need to be compliant with the legislative requirements. They have to be in a position where they can demonstrate how they are doing so. So there's, and I know these are points that have been raised at previous sessions. So I think there's a fundamental point around having that clear understanding of what the need or the demand is, and then also working with suppliers to find the most effective way of addressing that.
You said earlier, and I agree with you, and I think probably most of the folk in the committee would agree with you, is we have the legislation, but often the difficulty is the implementation. And often implementing what we want to see, which is good outcomes for all, is hampered by risk adversity and a misreading of the legislation and the guidance. How do we get over that?
Well, there is, for example, the engagement that takes place between officials and heads of procurement. There is the procurement journey, there's that support that I've spoken about previously. There is, it's been identified by the committee, and the point around implementation, I think it's always going to be inevitable when we have a diverse and sophisticated public sector landscape. There will be variations in implementation, and that can be for a multitude of reasons. With points around being risk averse, I would just highlight the need to ensure that all procurement activity is compliant with the relevant domestic and international obligations that we are subject to. I will maybe ask Graeme Cook to come in if he wants to give more comment just around some both of the points that you've raised in your previous two questions, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you. So the engagement of the front line. No procurement can go forward without the end user defining the specification. This is the minimum technical threshold, if you like, that has to go into a tender. Now, once you start layering in, yes, price is always part of it, but whether or not there's modern slavery in a supply chain, whether or not it's a high carbon impact product, whether or not a supplier pays the living wage, quite often that will change the brand that is ultimately delivered to the end user. And I do know through 20 years in public procurement, I do know that can come as a shock to the end user, and they'll often say, well, that's the accountant, that's the budget holder, and that's a lawyer that skewed the result away from what I was really wanting. But in reality, it's often, sometimes it will be down to, well, we just don't have the budget for something, and that's a local decision. I think the reality is more often that what changes the brand, what changes the final outcome, is actually the delivery of these fundamental policies that procurement is being asked to deliver. I think it's a bit of a... I think there's a multitude of things going on underneath the surface when someone says, well, it's the accountants that have changed the answer, some of which is actually exactly what I think the committee members expect the Act to be delivering.
And maybe some of it not, and that's what we're here to delve into. So let's look at some of the things that are going on out there. Mr. Cook said earlier that there are events and seminars to ensure that best practice is exported across the piece where it can be. And yet we see things going on out there at this moment which, are providing great outcomes for people, but it's not happening in a lot of places because it's seen maybe as being too risky. So let's give an example that we've heard about on a number of occasions in terms of the evidence that we've heard in terms of social care in my own home city of Aberdeen and the Granite Care Consortium. Commissioned work, a lot of flexibility whereby frontline workers can have the ability, the independence, the autonomy to step up and step down care. The contract allows for that. If that were happening elsewhere in the country, it would probably ensure that folk were not going into hospital as many occasions unnecessarily. Now, that has been picked up in certain other parts of the country, but not in many others. Why is it that kind of best practice in terms of procurement is not being exported across the board?
I think the first point is as implicit in what you've stated, and it echoes the points made earlier on about East Ayrshire, is it demonstrates what is possible within the existing legislative framework. That framework permits the kind of activity that you have described. So just bringing it to that focus of the question of why other public bodies, other contracting authorities do not take a similar approach, that will ultimately reflect the decisions they have taken. Of course, in the case of, touched on earlier, for local authorities, they are democratically accountable to their electorate. I won't rehearse the various examples I've given in terms of around facilitating sharing of best practice, whether that be in person or online. But with regards to how we can further support public bodies to share best practice beyond what we have already set out, I will of course very carefully consider what the committee's views and reflections are on that matter. But I think the key point is, when examples of good practice are identified, and this is a statement of the obvious, but they're occurring within the existing framework, they demonstrate what is possible. I don't know if there's any reflections that you have, Graeme, around this broader point of sharing best practice and maybe trying to unpack and understand why some authorities will take one approach and others may not choose to do that.
Yeah. If I could touch upon National Care Service, I appreciate that. That's outside the Minister's remit, of course, but the National Care Service is actually, that programme is looking at the Granite Care Consortium and the commissioning model there, and how that relates to procurement. So they're looking into that in some detail. So far, it looks like it was fundamentally a decision to buy something else. So it was the social care commissioners, the budget holders, the end users, who drove that change, and procurement then delivered what the commissioners requested. So there's, again, it's this system approach where multiple players will all impact in terms of what is bought and how a contract works. So they asked for something different. The procurement legislation allowed it. There was sufficient flexibility there. So the question that colleagues in the National Care Service programme are unpacking now, in consultation with various parties, is what was it that drove that, and why, let's say, who is it that needs to share what best practice? Is it commissioners of social care who need to share that best practice, or does it lie in procurement? Probably lies across them all. So that analysis is being done to look at why isn't that being spread right across the country right now, what barriers can be removed, and so on.
You kind of make my point for me, and I'm not going to go into depth in the National Care Service because the convener will not allow me the time, I'm quite sure, in that regard. But the National Care Service is around about uniformity, the best standards possible for best outcomes for people, creating that standard, high quality standard across the board. We're not there yet. However, Mr. Cook kind of makes my point for me, because people on the front line in Aberdeen came up with something different, and they've been allowed to go with that, whereby there has been risk aversity in other parts of the country where folks in the front line have wanted similar to Aberdeen, with that flexibility, that independence, that autonomy, and they've been told no, because those folks who are putting together tenders, documents, say, well, that's not possible.
I'm going to ask Nicky to come in a moment, but one of the things that would obviously highlight within the requirements around the strategies is setting out how they are, bodies are engaging with their particular area and the considerations that go into the strategy. But one of the other things that I will take away from this exchange is that in the community wealth building consultation, one of the central questions was around duties to be placed on public bodies around advancing community wealth building. Now, we're obviously giving very detailed consideration and reflecting on what the responses to the consultation were, But I think that particular point you raised around decision-making being more informed by the considerations of those in the front line and in the community leading to better outcomes is one that I will certainly take away in terms of thinking about how we take forward the propositions that we consulted on with regards to community wealth building. Sorry.
Yeah. I was just going to add, I made a point earlier and it was around the importance of the earlier engagement of procurement. So procurement and commissioning coming together much earlier in the process, so that that's a mutual process of development. And I think what we've discovered through an awful lot of work to assess what has been happening historically is that that closer collaboration hasn't always happened, and that's what's given suboptimal outcomes. And that is why the programme that's looking at it just now is taking the learnings from Aberdeen and elsewhere, how do you bring those communities much closer together earlier in the process to really define what needs to be done? And that's based on what the outcomes are we're trying to drive.
One final, very brief question. All of this is about people and the best possible outcomes for people. We've heard around about some of the work that has been undertaken in terms of the sharing of best practice and the attempts, I'm sure, to get rid of some of the risk aversity that still exists out there. I wonder if it's possible, Minister, for you and officials to provide some detail around about what has gone on in that area, say, over the past year, to give us a flavour of how you're going about that business.
Yeah, if it would be helpful to the committee, I'm happy to write back in time for you to consider as part of your report a summary of the activity that I and officials have been undertaking around engaging with contracting authorities, if that would...
It would certainly be useful for me, and I think it would be useful for other other members too. Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. Bob Doris, be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard a lot today about supply chains and transparency in supply chains and understanding ethical decisions that have to be taken in relation to paying a living wage, fair trade, a whole variety of things. The legislation that's been scrutinised comes from 2014. There's a bill going through the Scottish Parliament just now called the Circular Economy Bill. I sit on that committee, and we need to make sure that all decisions taken from public sector procurement plays its part in relation to a circular economy, and there'll be a circular economy strategy being developed in Scotland following the passage of that bill. Whether that's procurement from local authorities, NHS Scotland, Police Scotland, a variety of public agencies, that will have an impact. I would hope it will have a beneficial impact on all those public bodies. Can I ask the Minister what cognizance he's got of that legislation going through the Scottish Parliament and whether or not there's work cross-portfolio to make sure that Lorna Slater, who's leading that bit of legislation, for example, is talking to your department, Mr Arthur, to make sure that the public sector and its supply chains, which is the key thing, and its supply chains know what they need to do to play their part to make Scotland a truly circular economy?
Certainly. I'll ask Nicky to come in just to talk about the engagement that's been taking place between officials. What I would just, of course, want to highlight again is that we have been, in many respects, in procurement ahead of the curve in this in terms of what we set out in the 2014 Act around sustainable procurement, the suite of tools that we provide to support buyers and sustainable procurement obligations that are available. We'll ask Nicky to come into some of the detail.
We work very, very closely with the other portfolios. We work very closely with our climate colleagues, with our fair work colleagues, with our economy colleagues to try to drive the sustainable outcomes that we're trying to achieve through procurement. So when they're putting together legislation on climate, we're part of that discussion. And we have discussions, for example, you know, how can we make sure we do the right things for the people of Scotland, but without creating unnecessary burdens, particularly for the small businesses, and slow down the chance for small businesses to play in the public procurement supply chain. So, for example, on reporting duties, we reached an agreement that what our public bodies present on climate within their annual reports could be used for the climate reporting duties for procurement, so that they're only doing it once and they can use that for both. So it's trying to streamline what we can do. And also, as we're going out to the market, it's trying to take, well, we've written it into the policy and the guidance and the tools, taking a proportionate approach so that we don't inadvertently block out small businesses and we bring them on the journey of trying to deliver climate and circular economy ambitions. But climate and circular economy policy, guidance, tools, e-learning, we've mandated the e-learning to make our buyers climate literate, and it's available free of charge to all buyers across Scotland, and we track and monitor who's availing themselves of that free training to try to increase the knowledge and understanding of our buyers in applying these important considerations to the relevant procurements.
I find that encouraging, because I would say that I'm part of the deliberations as the committee draws the conclusion that this particular post-legislative scrutiny, I get the frustrations that sometimes committees that I sit on, we always think about what next rather than necessarily the good work that's taken place up until this date. But that's what politicians do. Can I just ask that when you mention burdens and on businesses, that I get that, but we have to think about what the right thing to do is, and supporting businesses to do the right thing rather than using necessarily the language of burdens on businesses, because if we're going to have a proper partnership between across portfolio, then we have to enable businesses to see the value in doing the right thing rather than talking about it in terms of burdens. Maybe the language has to be changed a little bit.
And maybe I used the word burdens in here because we're talking about trying to get access for small businesses. But when we're discussing with our suppliers, what we're trying to lay out and what we do lay out within the supplier journey is our expectations of our suppliers. So what outcomes are we trying to develop and deliver together? And that includes climate, fair work, and opportunities for community wealth and community benefits. So that is the language we speak in on bringing people with us.
And Ms Archer, I don't want to be a hypocrite, because the first time a local business contacts me to say there's too many burdens on us, I'm going to be making representations to government.
It's all a balance. Yeah.
I do have another question, convener. And we know that there's public bodies reporting annually in all of this, and we know there's strategies, but the committee has heard evidence that quite often there's an inconsistency in relation to that, particularly the aims that are contained within those reports and strategies actually been linked to outcomes in reality. And I didn't know there was an annual synthesis report, I do now, which pulls together some of that stuff. Does the Minister recognise those inconsistencies, and what efforts have been made to address those?
I think, again, as becoming the sort of go-to word of this session around balance and proportionality, there are specific requirements that have to be met, both in the strategies and in the reporting on. But of course, there is nothing that precludes a public body going beyond those requirements, and there is nothing that precludes a public body whose annual expenditure is below £5 million from also doing strategies and reports. So there is that flexibility there. And I think the importance of the flexibility also reflects is that different public bodies will be operating in different focuses in with regards to procurement. Of course, there are requirements that most public bodies will need to address through procurement, but there'll also be things that are more sector specific. If there's anything you want to.
Could I mention something on that, if you don't mind? We have some minimum requirements on what public bodies must put into their strategies and must put into their annual reports. And the other thing that my team do is we actually, in analysing every public procurement report, we also offer feedback on how they can be improved. So we gather them together into the Minister's annual report, but we also offer feedback on the strengths and how these can be improved. But again, there is a balance between another burden on our hard-pushed buying communities to document everything on an annual basis. So it's getting the balance between what must be recorded so that we can give a good account of our impact, and then going further than that.
Reference that I made to aims within strategies and within reports not been necessarily linked to outcomes, is that something that government's aware of? Because the committee will want to know whether that is a systemic thing or an anecdotal thing. How real is it?
So Minister mentioned earlier our approach to developing the public procurement strategy for Scotland. The very purpose, and that was something that was developed in consultation, in collaboration with public sectors across Scotland, to really set out what our priorities are together in terms of outcomes that are good for businesses and employees, good for places and communities, good for society, and that remain open and connected. That's our mantra, and that is how we set out our annual reports, and that is how our priorities are structured. So that strategy, that national strategy, is around pulling together in the right direction, aimed at outcomes.
Thank you. Yeah, so the in terms of setting out an aim and then what you buy in a particular year, there can be a distinction. So many contracts will be 4 years long, for example, as a fairly standard length. So you might have a strategy for several years where you want to deliver particular things, but you'll only re-tender that thing once every 4 years. So there will be, if you like, peaks and troughs of opportunity to deliver more things within particular contracts. So I'm sure that also has an influence in terms of what pops up in each annual report. But if you were able to look over a longer period, I'm sure you would see a greater correlation between the aims and the strategy and what's reported as delivered.
I think that's a very fair point. And just finally, because I should ask it because in my notes here, one of the inconsistencies identified has been reporting on fair trade products because of there's not an agreed definition as to what that actually means, and that makes reporting or reporting consistently or looking at trends very difficult. Is there a need for a clear definition in relation to that? Is that something the Minister's aware of, or is there work ongoing in relation to that?
Yeah, there are requirements with regards to the strategy, but there's also important flexibilities there to ask.
So, fairly traded goods, so avoiding the brand name Fair Trade, that's one particular company that is involved in fairly traded goods. There is a definition in the sustainable procurement duty and in the supporting policy guidance, training and so on in the procurement journey and so on. So in terms of delivering the duty and fairly traded policies, I don't think the definition is an issue. I think some of the reporting against delivery can sometimes underreport. So there are organisations that will concentrate on their own particular branded type of fairly traded goods. So some of the figures out there in public, I think, are underreporting because they're using only their own brand rather than the broader definition that exists within the procurement legislation, policy guidance and so on.
Okay, I'm sure the committee might welcome further details on that in writing. I don't take up more of the committee's time with this line of questioning, but there's a kind of tension there between there is a definition, but there's flexibility, and it's interpreted differently across public bodies. And I don't want to make something there that's not there, so some clarity maybe in correspondence might be quite helpful.
The rationale behind that.
Thank you. Yeah, I was going to request that because the Fair Trade Forum had said that their legislation has not set out a definition of fair trade, and that's led to significant variance in what is categorised as fair or ethical among public bodies. So if we could have the Minister says there is a clear definition, and it could be just the interpretation of that definition rather than the lack of a definition, but there is evidence we've heard that there's a difference in the way in which the authorities categorise or report their fair trade products.
We certainly do that. One thing I would say is that in addition to what we have in the legislation, we also have national policy that sets out clear guidance on some of these items. Mm-hmm. And it's the suite of legislation and policy that sets out the standards and the approach, which are then embedded within our tools for the buyers to use. But we'll follow up on that.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, panel. Thanks for all your answers so far. Minister, how has the Procurement Common Framework influenced engagement with the UK Government as the Procurement Act 2023 for England and Wales has been developed? And do you have any concerns about how such reforms might influence procurement in Scotland?
Well, I would say there's a good level of engagement that takes place between procurement officials in Scotland and the other nations of the UK. We have seen recent reform of procurement legislation, both by the UK government on behalf of England and in reserve bodies, and also in Wales. We look on with interest, you know, beyond the engagement that we have. I think what we've seen is, in many respects, other parts of the UK seeking to catch up with where we are in Scotland. I think we were, as we touched on earlier, very much ahead of the curve in terms of what we achieved in 2014. So there is different provisions that have come in via the UK legislation. We'll, of course, want to monitor that very carefully. We're always keen to understand different approaches in terms of any learning that we can take from that. But broadly, I think what we have in Scotland, and I think has been reflected in the evidence that the committee has taken, is a very strong piece of legislation and supporting regulations, buttressed by that comprehensive suite of guidance and support that we've touched on.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Okay, thank you. On Monday this week, I think, is when the annual report was published, the 2021-22 report, which you shared with the committee, which was appreciated. Just one question about the report. Maggie Chapman did raise questions around sustainability, and we've had a chat around the other legislation that's coming forward. But there's little change in the percentage of public bodies who evidence that they had regard for supporting climate change. That's unchanged at 71%. That is an issue that, you know, through other inquiries the committee have heard, that particularly SMEs, the difficulty they have in engaging with the climate change agenda, the maybe lack of support or knowledge, obviously the increases in the cost of doing business has put pressure on them. How do they prioritise it? I don't know if the Minister feels that one hasn't, you know, other ones have improved, that one's kind of sitting at 71%. If there's anything more he wants to say about the challenges and how public procurement can support businesses to meet their climate change responsibilities, and how it can help them shift the model in which they do their business.
I think this really builds in the line of questioning Mr. Doris was pursuing, and I'm conscious in terms of the answers that Nicky Archer gave, highlighting the need for that proportionate approach. Of course, we want to be supporting and encouraging and enabling businesses to go on that journey. If we do have a set of requirements that particularly small operators just do not have the capacity to comply with, then that's missing out on an opportunity to perhaps take them on that journey. With regards to terms of what emerged through the cumulative annual reports as reflected in the Minister's report. I don't know if there's any initial feedback that you want to provide, Nicky.
What I would say is that I think people are still finding it quite difficult to articulate what they're doing on climate. I think I mentioned earlier that procurement is part of a whole system, and it is important in terms, you know, if there's a make-buy decision and we decide not to buy, that won't make it to an annual report. Quite often, I think people are missing the opportunity to articulate demand management type strategies to reduce the cycle of scope 3 emissions right at the start, because we're buying less or we've got choice restriction. And what we're trying to encourage more and more buyers to do is to come forward with more of those examples. We know it's happening. We've got a national climate and procurement forum with representation from across the public sector, where we discuss and debate how we can move that agenda forward. We we take action. We prioritise where we're going to focus. So we prioritise, you know, where's the biggest impact that we can get. So we're doing a lot of work in construction, doing a lot of work in heat and fleet, we're doing a lot of work in vehicles, as you would expect, but also starting to more routinely consider climate and circular economy in any procurement. So there's a lot happening. I don't think we're quite as far ahead at being able to capture and report that as we would like. So it's definitely an area where we're focused.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of the evidence session this morning, and I now thank the Minister for giving evidence this morning and move into private session.